And we will have the opportunity at this time to hear from Mr. Russ Senti, who is the Executive Director of Lutheran Outdoor Ministry Center. And Russ is going to speak on the faith practice, encourage, and mentor. Mr. Senti is a great gift, comes from Texas to us at 2005, became Executive Director of LOMC. His favorite Bible verse is Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have made for you, says the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and to give you a hope. I had the chance to be at camp about a week ago. I think we had about 200 kids.
202.
Yeah, isn't that great? So the camp was just full, 202 and 203 with, no, 204 with you and me.
Yes, sir.
And one of the unique things that occurred while I was there is that I had a chance to visit with the counselors a little bit, and some of the counselors came from our sister camp, Lutherdale. And because we had so many kids at LOMC, they had less kids up at Lutherdale, they borrowed us counselors. Now, that kind of ingenuity and working together and being a church is the kind of spirit that Russ comes with us. Russ is anxious and wanting the children to learn to pray, and when they go to LOMC, they learn to pray. So, Russ, thanks for sharing us with us in this way. It's great to have you here, and we look forward to your presentation. Welcome.
Thank you. Bishop Wollersheim.
Mr. Senti.
Thank you for that kind opening remarks about me and my values, but this really is a faith practice talking about encouragement and mentoring, which brings us to our values. Our values of care and compassion and listening and love. In fact, if I were to put the whole thing together in terms of this faith practice, we have the opportunity to do that hourly. You have the opportunity to do it at lunch, in terms of a thank you to the wonderful hosts that have hosted us here at Augustana. We had an opportunity to do it yesterday in many of the joyous sessions of encouragement and hope that was amongst us yesterday with the election of our bishop and that wonderful worship service last night with the ordination of Pastor Jen. But today I thought we'd start this off with how camp would start off, a BLSE, a Bible Learning Study Experience. And so what we do at camp is start with a song. Please stand up and sing with me, "Our God is an Awesome God." And we'll use hand motions if you know them. Follow me. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Again, our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Thank you. And then we go with a skit. So I'm going to ask one of the counselors from our summer staff, Nicole Billups, to help me with a skit from Acts. It's from the 8th chapter, beginning at the 30th verse. Nicole will be Philip, and I will be the Ethiopian eunuch. Nicole has just heard from an angel. The angel said, "Go south on this wilderness road," and I am coming north on that same road.
Come, come in my chariot with me. Let's go.
Where's my slides?
Ah, there you go.
There it is. So, the definition of encouraging is to give hope or a promise. I'm wearing this blue shirt because blue is the color of hope. This blue shirt was designed for a new worshiping community called Freedom Lutheran, which I am a part of, which gives my wife and I much hope. The color of blue is used in pyramids. And the next slide shows a picture of what we just demonstrated with our skit. He commanded the chariot to stop, and both of them, Philip and the eunuch, went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. But when they come up out of the water, the spirit had whisked away Philip. He was gone, and there stood the eunuch. And what happened? The eunuch went on rejoicing and praising God. So when touched by hope, when touched by that encouragement, we become a rejoicing people. And I saw that just before lunch. I was watching, in particular, the program director that I had just hired just not 6 months ago from Belvedere. Her name is Amy Honing. Is Amy still with us? If not, just say hi to Amy. She's new to the Lutheran Outdoor Ministry staff, and she was just beaming from ear to ear, and so were her children, the 4-year-old Elijah and the 7-year-old Grace. And they were watching their pastor. They were watching their pastor just filled with the joy of hope and encouragement. And then when I saw Bill Bartlett hand that plaque over to their pastor, he was beaming from ear to ear, filled with that encouragement, because they had now, after their 4-year journey, reached hope and now move on to be a congregation in the ELCA. Praise be to God. In 1 Timothy, chapter 4, verse 12, it says, set the believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. Now, this is the mentor part of this faith practice. I suspect that everyone in here is a mentor, but I'm going to pick on a couple of them in particular that I have seen this past week at camp. If you were a confirmation pastor, if you brought your confirmation kids to camp, and there were 11 churches at camp this past week, stand up. Stand up, you pastors. There's one that brought them from Freeport. Well, thank you, Pastor Mark, for bringing those kids to camp. Thank you very much. Because camp was an amazing place for those confirmation students to experience God, to find encouragement, and to be mentored, not just by their pastor, but by the community around them, by the lifeguard, who's Ryan Johnson from down here in the Geneseo area, by their counselors, Nicole being one of those counselors. In fact, Nicole had a challenge. She had some kids from Quincy, Illinois, and two of them said, I'm being forced to come here. You know, I never even said anything to Nicole, because Nicole is such a wonderful, wonderful, hope-giving person. In her attitude and her ways, she just takes God's words and makes it hopeful and encouraging. And I saw those kids engaged in the ministry that was happening at LOMC this past week. Praise be to God. Other ways that hope comes is through people that are mentoring us in our lives. So at this particular time, I'd like to tell you a short story about my life, and then I'm going to ask you to share with your neighbor about yours. I had been in the oil patch for 27 years as a geoscientist. And in the year 2001, I was told by my company, Texaco Oil, that they were selling out to Shell Oil on the downstream and Chevron Oil on the upstream. And I had plans at the age of 48 to go to 55 or 60 or 62 to retire from this company, but that company wasn't going to exist anymore. And so I did a lot of praying, a lot of searching, a lot of listening to people, especially pastors in my life. And one of the pastors in my life was Pastor Kathy Howeisen. She was the director at that time of Luther Hill Ministries, about 90 miles outside of Houston, Texas, in a place called LaGrange, Texas. And Pastor Kathy said, come here, and this is after I took early retirement. She says, come here and volunteer. I volunteered the summer of 2002, the summer of 2003, the summer of 2004, And after the volunteering in the summer of 2004, Pastor Kathy said to me, I think you could be an ELCA executive director of a camp or retreat center. I said, Pastor Kathy, I'm not a pastor. She says they've changed the rules. She said, apply. So I applied to a camp in South Carolina, and I applied to a camp up here in Oregon, Illinois. I thought it was Oregon, the state. But God had a plan for me, and it was good, going back to my verse. And from that point on, I got an interview with Pastor Jeff Clements and four other wonderful people, and then I got a call on December the 20th, 2004. Come be the director of this camp in this state and do ministry in wonderful ways. And I've been doing that since January 15th of 2005. I have had such a wonderful time because that mentor, that person in my life, Pastor Kathy Howeisen, said, do it. Now talk amongst yourselves. Who said do it to you? Talk about a mentor in your life. Take a few minutes to talk. Okay, I've got only 20 minutes total, so please come back. How many people had a person in their life that they said was a father figure, either a father or a father figure? Raise their hand if they had a father figure. Well, being Father's Day tomorrow, if they're still alive, thank them. Thank that father or thank that father figure, because that's a huge part of mentoring in our lives, especially our younger lives. George down here said he had a boss when he was 17, 18 years old, all the way through going up to college, that taught him a lot in life about not only photography, but about just being life's experiences and being a life coach to George. How many people had mothers? Mothers in their lives. Yeah, my mom's in my life, yeah. They're the ultimate coach, aren't they? The ultimate mentor.
Good.
Russell, don't you remember? In fact, I told this story yesterday in my India presentation, because I had the fortune of going to India. But before I could go to India, this is last year, Esther Prabhakar had called me and said, "Do you want to go?" And I said, "I need to check with my mom." And I did. And she said, "Okay, you can go. There's 100,000 Lutherans down there in the Arcot Lutheran Church, and you got your H1N1 vaccine. You can go." Because she worries about me. She worries. My mothers always worry about their children. And now being a grandparent, praise be to God, we worry about our children and grandchildren. So remember these mentors in your prayers, in your gratitude, and in your lives. Now, the flip side of that coin is being a mentor. And I have one really short story to share with you about a mentor that came to camp this week. I won't call him out because it would embarrass him. But Pastor came to the camp this week with a heavy heart because he had just come from a hospice situation where he had said goodbye to his wife, and he wasn't sure whether he'd see his brother-in-law again after camp, because his brother-in-law was near death. And Pastor came into camp, and he was flustered and flurried, and we got him all set up with his confirmation experience and counselors. And all throughout the week, this pastor was engaged not only with his kids, but with the community around him. Pastor Mark, he was engaged with you and the community around you. Praise be to God, because Pastor Mark had an accident at camp. And this man just came out with great love and compassion and served in wonderful ways as a mentor and encouraging element of LOMC this week. I didn't realize the impact that this man had on my own staff from India. Tali from Valparaiso came to work for me 3 weeks ago. We got him through staff training. This was his first week of camp. Here's what Tali wrote to Pastor. "It was really a pleasure having you in our camp. Your presence made a great difference, and we really appreciate it. Thank you for your assistance throughout the week and for everything that you do. And I hope to see you again soon. Regards, Tali." And the campers. He put "and the campers" on there. So remember that there are those wonderful, wonderful mentors out there that you're being that you don't even know sometimes how you're touching the people in mentoring. Next slide, please. This is now the parents' Bible verse that I've chose for this Bible study. It comes from Deuteronomy, and I will read it. "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. Keep these words that I am commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children and talk about them when you are at home, when you are away, when you lie down, and when you rise. Bind them as a sign on your hand. Fix them as an emblem on your forehead and write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates." And I show this picture of a dining room table because as our children were growing up, we would have what we called family meetings. It wasn't necessarily a devotional time, but we shared about our lives. We talked about what was going good in our lives, what was going bad, what we were looking forward to, what we were scared about, and we had these conversations. Raleigh Martinson calls those caring conversations. And I didn't realize how important that was until I read that verse in Deuteronomy again and again and again. Because what we were doing was modeling that encouragement, that passing on of the faith, that mentoring to our children. And now I have a 27-year-old up at Lutherdale Bible Camp who wants to do the same with her grandson. She says, "We're going to have family meetings, Dad." Praise be to God for that. So parents, the King James Version of this Deuteronomy text says to teach them diligently. And to do it diligently, we have to really, really make more time in our lives for this type of faith practice, encouraging our children so that they will grow up in the faith as we have. Next slide, please. Bible studies. That's what we're in right now. Little camp style to start out with. Thank you again to Cole for helping me. In the process of the Bible studies, it's not only the learner who grows, but the one who mentors and teaches. The maturing disciple knows she is never finished, that the path of maturity continues to the day we exchange this life for the next. I love that, because seeds are being planted in these campers, And we'll have probably about 1,600 campers this summer. We'll have 13,000 by the end of the year in terms of people that come and experience God in the outdoor setting at LOMC. But seeds are being planted in terms of faith development, in terms of encouragement, in terms of hope. If there's one thing I want you to remember today, is that encouraging, that mentoring is delivering hope, both on the giving side and the receiving side. This is the receiving side. I'm not going to make you stand up, but raise your hand if you're a Bible study leader in your church. Bible study leaders. That would be confirmation. That would be youth groups. That would be Bible study leaders. Let's give them a hand for all that work. Thank you very much. So that's an important faith practice in our church, in our lives, in our camps, in our Sunday school rooms, in our wherever we have the opportunity, our family tables. Next slide, please. I picked this for a couple reasons. One is, remember Dr. Eccles said yesterday that we should pray at all times, or pray often and study the scriptures. And well, I get a daily scripture from a wonderful, wonderful new seminary student that's going into LSTC, into Dr. Eccles' institution, named Kwame Pitts. I got the wonderful, wonderful opportunity to work with Kwame last summer, and Kwame sent me this one day. It was Proverbs. Proverbs says, pleasant words are a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing to the bones. The Bible study, that little miniature email went on to say, treat a man as he appears to be, and you make him worse. But treat a man as if you already were what he potentially could be, and you make him what he should be. I didn't realize how powerful that was for me until I thought about something that I learned as a parent a long time ago. And this is that your kids will live down to or up to your expectations. Let me say that again. Your children will live down to or up to your expectations. Hold them with high expectations and help them achieve high goals in life, and you will be that encouraging mentor that this faith practice asks you to be. Now, I have another example from camp. A young lady from this town, I think it's Rock Island, maybe it's Moline, named Mila. Mila came to work for me 3 weeks ago. Mila's a wonderful young lady with a wonderful talent to play keyboard. And so she brought her keyboard with her. And our worship services at camp are now blessed with that keyboard talent of Mila, with a guitarist around her and a drummer over here. We have such a rich worship setting now because of Mila's talents. And she told me that she wasn't so sure that she had the ability to do this, but I encouraged her to bring the instrument, to just sit by the side of the campfire, because it runs on batteries, and play. And man, that instillment of those pleasant words and that encouraging words that brought Mila to a performance that I think was higher than what she expected to do at Lutheran Outdoor Ministry Center. Next slide. Remember I told you the color of blue is the color of hope? Anybody know where this is from? Anybody? New Orleans, Louisiana. Actually, all across the Gulf Coast, from Biloxi, Mississippi, New Orleans, Louisiana, to parts of Texas, this was the view. These homes had lost their roofs in the Hurricane Katrina and Rita. There were back-to-back hurricanes. I don't know if you remember the Rita one. Everybody remembers Katrina, but Rita was pretty devastating, coming right up the Louisiana-Texas border. This was the picture afterwards, covered with that blue tarp all over the place. And there's that picture of hope in that color. And I want to, hats off to our youth, who sent over 36,000 youth to New Orleans, Louisiana this past year to do God's work with their hands. And if you're in here, youth, take an applause. I can tell you from my own experience back in the Texas-Louisiana Gulf Coast is that the people of Galveston truly need that help as well. New Orleans got a lot of attention. Galveston didn't. Galveston got devastated in a recent hurricane. And so there's much hope still to be given in that area. Raise your hands. Who goes to Biloxi, Mississippi, or any part of the Gulf Coast to help out? Raise your hands. Oh, wow. Thank you all. Take a hand. Thank you. thank you for doing that faith practice, that encouraging, mentoring, hope-giving practice for the National Church. Now, I wasn't sure how to end this Bible study. I thought, you know, we could do it like a camp. We could end with another song. We could do another skit. But a mentor of mine in the business world, Cheryl Dawson, who owns her own company, taking people that have been laid off and finding them jobs, Cheryl sent me a clip of a recent poem written by a coach that I have admired for many, 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 many years in the basketball world and the college world. John Wooden, who died earlier this month, and I'm going to say he was 95 or 96, coached a lot of successful UCLA Bruins basketball teams. A lot. In fact, they beat the University of Houston in a famous game way back when. Well, John Wooden wrote this poem, and I'd like to have my Bible study on encouragement and mentoring end with this poem. Karin?
Don't look back. The years have left their imprint on my hands and on my face. Erect no longer is my walk, and slower is my pace. But there is no fear within my heart because I am growing old. I only wish I had more time to better serve my Lord. When I have gone to Him in prayer, He has brought me inner peace, and soon my cares and worries and other problems cease. He's helped me in so many ways. He's never let me down. Why should I fear the future when soon I could be near His crown? Though I know down here my time is short, there is endless time up there, and He will forgive and keep me ever in His loving care.
Amen.
Thanks, Russ.